When you analyze your data, probably one of the main goals of the analysis is in the end to produce a plot that can be included into your seminal work or into your thesis. And in this video, I will like to show you the plot command in R, which is kind of the basic plot facility in R. It's kind of a Swiss Army knife, with which you can already produce a lot of different plots here. And it also works for a lot of different situations. So most of the specific objects in R coming out of specific analyses have a plot method attached to that, and you can always access this method by using just the plain plot command. So we will again work with our Münzingen data, and I will at first load them into a variable which I call Münzingen again, and I read them with a CSV2 command, read CSV2 because it's a continental CSV format, and I specify the place where to load, and again I set row names equals to 1 because our row names are stored in the first column, and here we have them again. So we could immediately use the plot command on one of these columns, one of these variables here, for example plot Münzingen dollar, let's say the length of the fibulas. When I do that, you can see here already the plot, and this plot here, this diagram, this chart, has some elements that you probably will see in most of the other plots. So usually you have some kind of an x-axis, which specifies the first variable you plot with. When I don't specify anything here in the plot command, when I only specify one variable, this is the index, so just this is the first, this is the second, the third fibula, and so on in our data set. And we also have a y-axis, which usually gives you the reaction, the intensity or the value of the variable. And in this situation we have here the plot length, and already here you can see some tick marks with some numbers here representing where the values, how big the values are. You also see here some labels, index here and length here, which directly falls out of the name of the variable specified here. We can change them later on to be more nice. And also you can see here our data plotted, this time as a scatter plot, as a dot plot. So we could also specify two variables here to plot the relationship of one variable against the other, and I will add here the foot length of the fibula, which is here FL. Now you can see that the thing has changed. Now length is on the x-axis and the foot length is on the y-axis, and you can already see here the distribution of the data. We have two fibulas which are kind of extreme, and here's the rest, and there seems to be some kind of relationship going on between the length and the foot length. They seem to be connected, which is obviously or expectable. So with that, you already see some structure in the data. If you want to have an idea how you can enhance the plot or change the options of the plot, the command for that is par, and if you look into the help of par, you can see here set or query graphical parameters, and you can see there's a lot of different options that you can use to adjust your plot in a specific way. We will only talk about a few of them, but you can always look them up here in the help file. What I will now do is to split our plot area into different panels, and to do that I use the par mf row. So with that I specify how many plots in row and column should be visible at the same time, and to do that I specify a vector. I say, let's say, three rows of plots and also three columns. When I do that, nothing seems to happen here. also nothing here, because this will then be in action for our next plot. Let's go to some different plot types, and this is just how the data are visualized here, some very basic types. You can also look them up in the with the plot command. So here is the are the plot types given, and I will go through all of them that you have an idea what they are doing. So at first I could say plot our data as a type equal to P, and that's the standard default setting here. You will see the same plot again, but now a bit smaller. And so this is a dot point plot, and the data are given here as just points. You might also, if you have a continuous phenomenon, you might also like to connect the individual points with a line, or just display a line, and that's type L for line. And you can see here now the individual fibulas are connected by lines, and this gives you a crisscross pattern here because it goes through the objects in their order in the data set and draws a line from the first to the second to the third. And since we haven't ordered our data set in the first place, this gives you a kind of a mess here. If I just remove the foot length here from our plot, now the plot probably makes more sense visually, because now we can see probably that there would be a development going on if this category here on the x-axis would have been meaningful. So there's a basic rule: if there's a continuous process that you would like to display, that's a good idea to use a line here. If whatever is here on the x-axis represents a continuum, this index doesn't represent a continuum because there's no real connection between the first and the second in respect to their placement within the variable. So in that case, lines are not should not be used here. And that's true for a lot of scatter plots you see around. Often people draw lines between things that are logically not related on the x-axis, and in this case you should not draw a line there and question this kind of plot there if other people do that. Okay, but let's look to other plot types and ignore the fact that we are currently doing something statistically wrong here with this kind of plot. So I could also specify the plot type B, and this gives you a mixture of lines and points. So you can see here the individual objects are given as points, and they are connected via lines with a bit of space around the point. So this is a good way to visualize on the one hand the data themselves, but also this connection between the data. We could also use type C, and this gives us only the lines with some space in between the connections here. And you might like later, and we will see that on the scatterplot video, you might like to fill that up with different information. For example, you could also display the text here that describes the data, not the point that gives you the specific location of the data. Next thing we could look to is the option O, and this is kind of the same like the option B, but in this situation here the line is drawn also through the points themselves, so no space around the points, but the line goes directly through them. Next option we would like to probably see is the H option. It stands for horizontal, for histogram actually, I think. So in this case you see that there are lines drawn from the x-axis until the point where the data ends. So this, in this case, it's quite long fibula, and you can see that here by this long line here. And I can imagine that there are a lot of use cases where they like to prefer this kind of visualization. It's not strictly a bar plot, but it functions in the same way, and yeah, there might be the possibility to would like to use that. And the last thing, kind of the last thing we will see here is the S option for step. In this situation, you can see that there's a horizontal line drawn until the next data point, and then there's a step to this next data point, and again a horizontal line, step to the next data point. So you get this stepwise, this staircase representation of your data. And this is, for example, a good situation when you have no linear connection between, so there are no in-between values here, but still there might be some structure or order going here on the x-axis. I will reset our plot window that it displays only one plot at a time with the command parmfro equals to 1, 1. And when I now repeat this plot here, you can see now it fills again the whole plot window. So with that, you can combine different plots already within a plot, and to get back to just one plot at a time, you can use this command to again fill the whole plot with just one. Okay, the last plot type I would like to show you is the plot of type N. And you can see no data are drawn at that time. It just sets up the frame of the plot of the diagram with specifying the range of the data in the x and y axis, and also plots the axis here and the labels and additional parameters as a kind of a blank sheet, which you can later on fill, for example, with the text command with individual values here displayed in a specific situation. So in case you just need at first a diagram that has the size of the data that you want to display, the plot N option becomes in handy. We will talk about that also probably more during when we explain scatter plots in more detail. Plot is also kind of an intelligent system because it also relates to the kind of data that you are plotting with and changes the display accordingly. So for example, if I plot a nominal variable like the Fibonacci, you can see it switches from this scatter plot display to something that's like a bar plot, or is actually a bar plot, and show you now the amount of the number of data that you have in respect to the different categories here. So, and this is true also for other objects. Already said that for different objects, most of the time there's a plot function implemented specifically fitting this kind of object. So if you, for example, have the result of correspondence analysis, and you throw that into the plot command, you will get a plot that the authors of the command thought might be the best representation of your data. Let's now make a more enhanced plot of our data, a plot with more graphical display, more parameters to show you a bit how you can manipulate the plot. And I will just put the command up here and now describe what the different elements are for. So in the first place, as before, we give the x-axis and the y-axis for the data. This command here gives you the limits of the x-axis. So our plot should start from 0 to 140. And if I just, for example, start at 50 here, you can see now the plot starts at 50 and all the data before are not displayed any longer. So with that, you can zoom in a way to your data. The same is true for the y-axis. This xlab parameter gives you the label of the x-axis. Accordingly, the Y lab. Then we have the main here, and then with it you can give the main title of the diagram, and the subtitle is given here below with that parameter. With that, you think you have already a kind of graphical appealing display that gives you a lot of information and possibilities here. You can also add some lines, some later elements to such a plot, for example lines, and one command in that direction is the appline command, where I can specify that there should be a straight line drawn according to specific settings. For example, I can have a horizontal straight line that should be drawn at, let's say, 40. When I do that, you can see here there is a horizontal line drawn at 40. This might not be so interesting here. I mean, if there's any sense to draw a line at 40, you can do it like that. But probably more meaningful would be to draw a line here at the mean of the Münzingen data, and in respect to horizontal line, we could use the foot length here as the mean value of that. I just repeat this plot to get rid of the old line, and with that you can see now here there's a line at the mean of these values. And I also probably change the color of that. For that I can use the call command. Let's say this line should be red. You can use this call command also generally in the plot. I will just show you that. Call should be, let's say, yellow. Now we have yellow points, not so visible, so I will remove that again. Now we have black points here, and now I draw a red absolute line horizontally at the mean of the foot length. And I can do the same for a vertical line, for example, with the V parameter, and this time I use the mean of the length, and I make that green. Now we have a green line here showing us the mean of our fibula length. We could also draw a trend line into our data with this appline, so a diagonal line that represents the trend within our data. And to do that, we use the appline command again. And we will talk about that more when it comes to regression very much later on in the course. But just to show you this, that you can use that as a graphical display. So let's say we want to draw an appline from a linear model, whatever it is. The foot length in relation to the length from our data that is coming from the Münzingen data set, and it should be colored blue. And with that, you can see here now a line that describes best the trend in the data in a blue display. I already said that we can also add text later on, for example, if we just use the plot type n before and then later on plot text into that. Also that I will describe more when it comes to scatter plot, but just to give an annotation to these lines here. So at the moment they are quite not so meaningful just from looking at them. I will explain now just this horizontal line giving the mean of the foot length. And to do so, I use the command text. And again, I have to specify where the plot should take place. So I think it would be good to have that here somewhere. So from the x-axis, I say it's at 110. And on the y-axis, it should be near the mean of our foot length, that it is near the line here. Then I specify the label that should be used to display, and I will start let's say mean foot length. And if I just go for it like that, it gives you here the term, the word mean foot length somewhere here, but we could elaborate that a bit more. For example, position that to above the line, and if you want to look up what kind of possibilities you have to specify objects here. Again, you can look up the help of the text function. Position 3 puts text above the position that we specified here, so above the line. Now we have mean foot length above the whole thing. And it's quite big. Let's make that a bit smaller. So with CX parameter, you can determine the size of the text. I say it should be 70% of the original, of the standard size. Now you can see here is a smaller version popping up. And you can also see that all the plots, all the text commands are just added to the already existing plot. If we want to have a clean situation again, we have to start over from our original plot command and repeat everything what we did before. And now we have here a label. And it might be nice to also numerically display the mean length here. To do so, we use a command that's called paste. And with that, we can glue text parts together, paste, mean foot length, and then the actual mean foot length. So with that, oops, there is something missing, comma here. Okay, now let's clean that up again. Now we can see here the mean foot length in numerical values. This is quite ugly because it has so much points after numbers after the point here. So we would probably like to round that value to the second decimal position. And again, repeat all that. Let's say. We have to put the parameter at the right place because it's a parameter of round and not a parameter of paste. So again, cleaning that up. Here we go. Now we have to put foot length here, rounded to the second place after the decimal separator. I think, this already gives you some options to work and to enhance your plots. When you have now your plot available, you might like to use that in different contexts. So just having them at display in our studio doesn't help you so much. You can see already here, there's this nice export button. And if I use that, I can specify if I would like to export that as an image, which means a raster image. And I can do that like that here. Can specify how big the image should be and what image type it should be. Actually, these two here are vector images. I will start with a raster image as a PNG. And you can also name the plot. So my super plot, and save that PNG. Now you can see here my super plot PNG is saved. And I also can zoom in here, and now you can see the raster thing because it's rastered. You have individual pixels here. Another option would be to export that as PDF. Again, my superplot.pdf. Also, you can specify the sizes here. And now when I zoom into this PDF, you can see that there's no pixelation going on because it's a vector file. So all the information here is stored as geometrical information, and you can zoom in as far as you like. This vector format is fitting for publication when the whole thing should go into print, so that the print machine itself can define on what resolution the whole thing should be printed, while the raster images most of the time are very fitting to including that into a presentation also, so for displaying that in on the screen. You could also do that outside of RStudio. If you work with pure R, if it comes to vector images, you can, for example, use also PDF from with a command, produce a PDF from a command, and the command here would be copy to PDF. You specify file name here, file should equal to, let's say, test PDF. And when I do that, the content of your current plot one window is copied to your file system under that name, and it looks like that. So essentially more or less the same like we if we used the export function. So with this you can also export directly within, for example, a script. So what we have also in the menu, there is, so these standard R plots are kind of partly not so well for publication. They might do their job, but they always look a bit homegrown. There is a library ggplot with which you can produce very publication ready plots. I will not go into detail here, and I will later on in the course use only the standard graphics, but just to give you a first glimpse on this package, I will load that here, library ggplot2, and we can achieve more or less the same result like that if we specify ggplot of our Münsingen data. The aesthetics should be like x should equal to length, y should equal to foot length, and I want to have a point plot here. And if I run that command, you can see this looks kind of nicer, and there's a lot of options to also enhance even this display here. But you can also see that ggplot follows a very specific philosophy and its very specific syntax here. And not to confuse you with another syntax, we will not consider this plot library any further. But you might like to look that up yourself. For example, here at the web page for ggplot, ggplot.tidyverse.org, where it's currently placed, and here you can have some information how to use ggplot and what you can do with that. And also a good source for information is the quick R homepage that's now hosted under statsmethod.net, and here you can see, for example, a lot of informations for different R related topics, but also how to you can produce graphs and, for example, here dot plot, scatter plot, and other things with some examples on how this should look like. So that's a good source if you want to have an idea how you can represent your data. Look either here up, or if you feel comfortable with ggplot, that gives you quite good and nice looking results. Next time we will talk about more about specific plot types in with using the standard R plot function, and to display specific types of data. But remember, this plot function is always the basis, and you can do already a lot with just the plot function.